You get hooked. It's an addiction.
I didn't want to do my homework. I would practice all day long. It seems to have this natural ability to hook you.
It's a real high. It's a drug, I think.
It's obviously not a narcotic, although the addiction seems to be as strong between the ages of 14 and 18.
May also bring inner peace. The concentration brings you peace.
For me, it's real magic because there's no gimmick to it.
It changed my life. It did. It was my coming out party.
It's the only thing that I've ever done that I'm good at. I wasn't that good a chemist.
Living in Chicago, and my first wife had just left me. It was a rainy Sunday. I was bored and depressed. I had a friend who knew how to juggle, and he'd shown me how to teach myself. And I thought, yeah, I can't possibly do this. So I picked up three objects. There was a little bottle of whiteout, and a golf ball, and a little super ball, and I started throwing them around. And at the end of a couple of hours, I couldn't juggle, but I wasn't bored and depressed anymore.
I was always an uncoordinated kid, so I started juggling because I thought it would help me become more coordinated. It didn't, but it was still a lot of fun.
One thing about juggling is you didn't have to put on any persona to go do it. You could just be yourself, and I preferred that. I like the honesty of that. I love seeing a street performer get out there and be himself, maybe very extreme self, but there's no artifice there.
Oh great, a volunteer!
Sadiet and I have been working on this act for a long time. Right, Sadiet?
I would consider myself as a person who has dabbled in the art of juggling to give himself a reason to be on stage.
Just relax, Sadiet. Don't worry about a thing. Just totally and completely relax. Put your head straight on down there. Sadiet, what I'm going to attempt to do here is I'm going to attempt to juggle three objects. So, ladies and gentlemen, I did a lot of birthday parties for kids when I was first starting out. Now I'm getting all these little suckers back one by one.
I can bring the worst out in people, but I can bring the best out in them as well.
If you study the origin of the word juggling, it comes from the root word joculator, which means to make laugh or to make merry.
In French, it's called a connivence. They have a kind of connection with objects.
And to me, juggling is visual music.
Women invented juggling, not men. These women were juggling 4,000 years ago, and I can distinctly see, as a juggler, that the artist understood what they were doing juggling-wise.
You don't need to speak. It's a beautiful visual.
And these tricks are still done today, and there's been no real improvement on it. What has changed, maybe, is that now men juggle. My father could juggle three balls, and I would pester him to do it, and he got sick of it. You know, I really became a pest, and I'm capable of being a real pest, especially when I'm a little kid. And finally, he just said, you know, I'm tired of this. You know, I tried to get him to perform at a picnic, and I would be his assistant. He wanted no part of that, you know. So finally he said, this is what it is. He didn't teach me, mind you, how to do it, but he showed me what it was.
Ladies and gentlemen, the great Rustelli.
Juggling is really simply defined as the manipulation of objects through space using human force.
It's a mathematical equation controlled by a human.
It's the dance of objects.
For me, as long as you manipulate anything, then you're a juggler.
Rustelli is known as the god of juggling.
Rustelli thought it was the most important activity that people could do.
I've taught college professors that just wanted to go in a grocery store and pick up three oranges, you know?
Well, juggling is kind of silly, and juggling is kind of cute, so I guess where I would get offensive about would be if they thought that wasn't a valid reason to be doing it. My name is Andrew. I'm from Boulder, Colorado. I'm the only one in my family who juggles. My sister did teach me, but she's forgotten how since. And they all like to watch me juggle. They don't like the fact that I dropped out of school. They don't like the fact that I don't have a real job. And they don't like the fact that I hitchhiked 1,500 miles to go to a juggling festival. But they're okay with it, really.
My father said, Bobby, I don't care what you do in life, as long as you're the best. I was a chemist at Vanderbilt, had just completed my master's degree in organic chemistry. When I quit Vanderbilt and I went off to be a juggler at Opryland, I assumed my father was gonna just really freak and be ashamed of me. Instead, he was so proud, he went around telling his fellow colleagues that his son became a juggler and a street performer. That was a cool guy.
What can you do if you don't get accepted into college, or what other opportunities can you have? And there was a big page, and there was three columns, and one you could have been a rodeo guy. Another one, you could have gone to clown college, and another was a school for chimney sweeps. I remember it was 1979. I remember that magazine. I ripped it out and I took it away because the guidance counselor told me, yeah, your grades are really good. You can go to about any college you want. I was in the top 1% in SAT. You can go wherever you want. And I had this clown college ad in my paper, in my pocket. No one knew about it. And I sent off for the admissions form without telling anybody. It was my big secret.
Dan's always been obsessed with the art of golf. In fact, last year, he set a Guinness World Record by bouncing the ball on the face of a wedge. How many? About 14,281 times.
It took me over 3 hours and 20 minutes.
That's right.
And right now, I'll attempt to beat that record.
There's two times I get to think, you know, other than when I'm just in a catatonic state. One is when I'm juggling, and the other is when I'm doing my laundry at the laundromat.
You're completely immersed in this juggling, in this concentration of juggling, and you are finding strength, inner strength.
There is a magic to it, and it is spiritual.
I do sense that I leave my physical body when I'm juggling.
Sometimes you reach a point where everything does seem to slow down. You can see the clubs coming at you in what seems like slow motion. You can watch the way they're turning, reach out your hand and decide when to pluck it out of the air. And
I think he's the world's greatest juggler, and I'm sure when you see him, you'll all agree with me. Mr. Francis Brunt.
When Astelli died, Francis came up, and he took all of juggling and elevated it. He brought it on a higher platform, he moved it, he modernized it, and he moved very fast.
He was blinding in speed. A lot of the jugglers were juggling maybe at 35 mile an hour. He actually was juggling at 62 mile an hour.
My name is Ernst Kuhn Montego. I'm from Germany. I was inspired by a juggler I saw in a movie when I was 12 years old, and it turned out that that juggler was my brother. I had never seen Francis because of the war. We grew up apart, and we have the same dad, and I didn't know that I have a brother who's a juggler. I was supposed to become an architect. Anyway, I saw my brother, which I didn't know at that moment, for 30 seconds in a movie, and I went home and I said, that's what I'm going to do. So I learned by myself. Everything I did, I had no teacher. I rehearsed all day and I went my way. And it turned out in years later that at the same time, continents apart, we had developed the same tricks. I'm coming back after this surgery, and to prove to myself and to everybody else that I can do everything with two steel hips.
In juggling, one problem, you must maximum relax and maximum concentration, you understand? And then you really juggle.
Someone who does it well makes it look so easy.
Many people consider Bobby May the greatest comedy juggler ever. He was the first, or the only juggler that headlined in vaudeville. He wasn't verbal at all, so he was able to be funny just by his style.
Bobby May was juggling clubs that were probably in the range of 12 to 16 ounces, which by today's standards is absurdly heavy. It's something that you do to entertain other people. And, you know, maybe you use it to say something about yourself or something about the nature of the universe, you know, something about the human condition.
How can you ever compare two jugglers and say one is better than the other unless you're going to say that, you know, you have to do a mandatory this, 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 and this, and then you're taking all of what makes a juggler unique away from them?
Creativity, genius, insanity, musical ability, allergies, nearsightedness, and left-handedness are all correlated together. And I guess if that's true, then juggling belongs perhaps on that same list also.
If it calls you, it's very easy to be a juggler. It would be difficult to stop.
I never met a person that didn't want to learn how to juggle.
Everybody can do it. There's no boys' way and girls' way.
But jugglers can't make a living just throwing objects. They've got to be funny, intelligent, personable. Punchlines coming at you all the time.
Say, Henry, you know I'd rather juggle and eat.
No, I didn't know that, but I know that you better juggle or you won't eat.
Oh, I can go home to Mother.
That's better than bringing the old battle axe on here.
Are they corny?
If you could be funny, if you could be entertaining, no one cares what you're doing, really.
I'd like to present to you, for the first time, in public, the amazing, is it Chuck? Right. The amazing Chuck on the flute.
Right.
juggle live kittens anymore. My name is Edward Jackman, the guy with the bike on his face. For some reason, if you say balanced on your head, it's not as funny as balanced on your face.
You know, we're trying to add more music now and branch out.
Do a song.
I would, but my voice is very bad.
I choose to do a high-energy, fast-paced show because I think that really turns people on.
If performers didn't separate themselves, didn't hide behind that prop so much, and allowed more of themselves to come through to the audience like a W.C. Fields did. He was a great juggler, but you don't know him as a juggler. He was doing tricks. It mattered who he was.
The juggling itself is not the selling point. So if you're the juggling Elvises, obviously you're big fat Elvis or something. You know, from the back row, they see, oh, it's Elvis juggling, you know.
It's not the juggle, it's the juggler.
It's basically designed to confuse kids who are generally pretty easily confused to begin with, because, you know, you just kind of do something like this, and you look at them, and they try to figure out what's going on. And you say, hey, which bowl's not moving? And they say that one. You say, are you sure? And they say, wasn't that one? No, wait, I mean, the other one. No, wait, Mr. Juggler Man, you're making my brain hurt. My full name is Steve Brown. That's as far as I generally like to go. I had kind of a shaky early life. Things were in and out, and everything was very transitional. I moved around a lot. And I don't know, as soon as I stepped in the juggling community, it felt like something permanent. I literally started juggling because I was homeless and needed a job. I was sleeping on the roof of a Subway sandwich shop. And Greg, the owner of Infinite Illusions Juggling Supplies, used to go to this coffee house that I hung out at a lot. And I just harassed him for like a month. I said, so when are you gonna hire me? Every time I saw him, just every single time, I would not shut up. And I started working there, building these yo-yos actually. And I just started playing with them and practicing and decided, well, let's see if I can actually learn how to use the damn stuff. I can probably make a little bit more money. So I taught myself how to use everything and I just fell in love with it. As a whole, generally, the juggling community is extremely welcoming and I really dig that.
There's a lot of PhDs. There's a lot of mathematicians.
Many computer scientists, many doctors, lawyers.
These are fields where there is a high premium placed on truth.
Not lawyers. Maybe one or two lawyers.
Just like that.
Most of the people juggle because it's a right brain break in their left brain day.
When I was 19, 20, I had a beard down to my belly button filled with sand and dead birds and stuff, and that was just my thing I needed to do.
It's a family, it really is. You know, it's just a family with a few more dysfunctional members than most families.
What? What's happening tonight?
It's not even
a stamp.
There must be, you know, and it's
okay. All right.
So hair was a big thing in growing up for me.
Well, the difference is I wear a shirt.
Okay, back to Robert. Dull and boring Robert.
What was the question? Is there any pie?
Around the ankle?
Ooh. With socks on.
Oh, yeah.
Cool. That's a first.
Yeah. And now the most impressive trick at all, between the legs.
Oof.
Of course, it's much more impressive when I do it without the golf club. Oh, my word.
You go. My name is Barry Friedman. This is my partner, Daniel Holzman. And we are the Raspini Brothers.
We do a corporate juggling show for corporate people.
The average audience isn't interested in you going out there and juggling 11 objects and making 5 mistakes.
You show me 6 clubs, well, it doesn't look that much different from 5. Show me 7, well, that's great. You're a good juggler.
They're more interested in seeing you go out there and juggle three or four objects and either having some comedy or a real pleasing presentation.
Show me something new.
You ask for it.
The reason I think beanbags are better than balls for a beginner is if you drop them, they don't go anywhere. Now, you can practice an hour of juggling with a beanbag, and you're actually getting 52 minutes to 55 minutes of juggling. And you do it with the balls, and you're getting about 38 minutes. You're spending 22 minutes chasing the balls around the floor.
You start with one ball.
In one hand, throw it to the other.
You make an upside-down V in the air.
And then you add the second ball.
Left, right, catch, catch. Left, right, catch, catch.
You try with two. Oh, boy. I was never a great juggler.
Go to the side and practice that for 10 minutes.
And you work your way up to three.
Just go throw, 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 catch, catch, catch. Throw, 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 catch, catch, catch.
I am Forrest Hobbs. I came to this planet by way of St. Joseph, Missouri. When I was doing my knife throwing, I was very interested in doing something different. And so I thought, why don't I juggle the knives before I throw them? Or better yet, why don't I juggle them and throw them? I was what you call stunt happy. Anything that was unusual, be it yo-yos or the bat paddles or anything like that, I was really interested in. Spinning tops and catching them on your hand and running them down the string. One time I'd throw a pair of sunglasses up behind my back and turn and catch them on my nose, all that kind of stuff. Balance a flaming cone till it burnt right down till it was almost burning my nose. And stuff like that. It was comedy, novelty, juggling. And it went over pretty well. Like I said, I was never a great juggler, but I did please the audience and the agents, and that's all you had to do to make a living with it.
I'm happy to be able to, you know, just get out, do a gig opening for some punk rock band or something who needs an opening act, you know, get out there, eat a light bulb, hammer a nail up my nose, and do some juggling yo-yo tricks. You know, that's my ideal living at this point.
I would like to earn a living at it. However meager, I would like to earn a living at it. If I can't manage to perform at all, I would like to do juggling school, anything.
When you go for a loan at the bank and you say, well, I'm a professional juggler, they go, you can make money? You can make money doing that? You can make a living doing that?
Yeah.
Pretty good one.
I always told myself, I'll tell you my age, that I would know how to juggle five clubs by the time I was 30, and I'm 33, and I still can't do five.
Practice doesn't make perfect. Perfect practice makes perfect. It is also completely magical that there's all these things up in the air tumbling all together in unison and landing in my hands one at a time and somehow not hitting. When those moments happen, they make the years of effort seem worthwhile.
If you're not obsessive about something, you're going to be depressive about everything else.
Not juggling everybody need for professional, you understand? This is very good for physics.
But it's not so good for the nervous.
I'm Sergei Ignatov, and this is my daughter. Yes, and I am...
Sergei Ignatov, juggler.
This is my face.
Ignatov is the one that a lot of us will arguably say is the, you know, the greatest technical juggler that ever lived.
He opened his juggling act with stuff that most people would have been very proud to close their act with.
Sergei Ignatov, juggler.
Ignatov again moved it technically to the unbelievable, things that hadn't been done before.
He has broken down the actual physical act of juggling into its absolute bare elements, analyzed it completely, and come up with a technique, a precision that is almost robotic.
And just from watching his rhythms, I improved my juggling.
And it was beautiful, and you knew it was difficult. The point of it, I think, was that it was beautiful.
People like my father, not everywhere, and it's very hard to be like his. I don't know, I think for me it's impossible.
When fathers practice with daughter, this is big problem. This is problem fathers and teachers, you understand? Because if I say this is green, she always say me this is white, you understand?
It's very hard. It's very hard. Ну вот меня спрашивают. It's very hard. Because he wants my juggling better every time, you know, but it's not every time for me very easy, you know, it's very hard for me.
I like the formality with which this father and daughter work.
Ну, я могу сказать по-русски.
Скажи по-русски.
Я говорю, что я не могу ответить
на
это.
Ну ты поняла, что я сказал?
Я поняла, что. Yes, it is.
In other words, she was the student and he was the teacher. It wasn't the father and the daughter in those moments.
Interesting feeling, you know.
She
from hate to love.
When in this moment hate me.
Yeah.
What is problem?
I don't have so much power, you know, and he don't understand it. But no, he understand it, but he can't believe this, you know.
I try to understand who is she in this world, and she try understand who she is through this juggling.
I don't want to be the daughter. I want to be myself. I want to be Katya Ignatova, you know. I don't want to be the it's the daughter of Ignatova.
I practice every day 3 hours, 3-4 hours together, and I think in future. She will be not so bad.
That's what I mean.
Katya Ignatova is one of the best jugglers I've ever seen. Man, would it be really neat to spend the rest of your life helping them do a really good act? You know, to make sure that her props were all right and everything was clean and the stage was clean and to get to see as many of the throws that she makes for the rest of my life as I possibly could. I would love that. I mean, I'd love to be their footman or whatever, I don't know, their butler, whatever that job is, for the least amount of money they wanted to pay me that I could live on. That would be great. That would be my next choice for a job. In fact, I'm making myself available right now, okay? That's a firm offer.
One of the things that I notice that people assume when you're juggling in a park or in a public place is that you're a clown.
I don't know how many times I'm, you know, asked, hey, do you know this clown? Do you want to be a clown? No, definitely not.
I don't like clowns. I don't care for clowns in the slightest.
That I always have to overcome the red nose, orange hair, floppy shoe sort of ideology that people think of juggling.
I can't stand to be called a clown.
I mean, I was a chemist at Vanderbilt, and all of a sudden, I'm a clown. I'm a kiddie clown. I mean, at least 2-3 times a week, I get someone walk into the shop and see me juggling and go, oh, are you a clown? At which point, I look at them and go, no, are you a clown?
I personally would like to see it treated with a little more respect by the general public and not viewed as, oh, I see you juggle. You must. Do you work in a circus? Are you a clown or something like that? My name is Bruce Thiemann. I am known as Boppo.
There he goes. Look at that. Boom, 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 boom. That is so hard.
Oh, and again, right before it hit the ground.
And I have his home phone number.
I wasn't going to do it, but I had it in my pocket, and I was planning to anyways. Oh, that's not it. Oh, there it is. Three balls.
Yeah.
Not quite the response I was hoping for.
Probably not quite the trick they were hoping for, so that's fine. There you go.
The vast majority of jugglers spend the vast majority of their time juggling.
I suspect that all that throwing and catching makes for less dropping in everyday life.
In Europe, it's funny because juggling is a marginal activity. I mean, really marginal. And no bag people in France, for example, they're jugglers.
Anyone who really wants to put in 5-6 years of practice can juggle, you know, 6-7 clubs and 9 balls and 10 balls and things like that. Sheer brute force doesn't really impress me that much.
Even I could probably manage to do 15 balls myself on the moon if I were to go there, and there's a room with a nice high ceiling and I had a few years of getting used to the gravity. But I'm not scheduled to do that.
We both have the knowledge to appreciate pure technical burliness.
Yeah.
But to me, it's like anybody can look at it and learn it. It's the people who are adding new tricks or inventing their own tricks, inventing new props and new ways to present it that it's more impressive to me.
It's finesse. You know, I've sat and watched people juggle 9 balls before, and then I've looked over and seen someone doing something amazing with 3 that impressed me even more.
Through these objects, we're having a relationship not only to ourselves, but as performers to the audience, to show them what, who you are. It's not the juggle, it's the juggler that people are interested in seeing.
I don't think we've ever had a juggler who had the whole package, which is the charisma, the skill, like Arnold Schwarzenegger in bodybuilding.
Before him, it was like, what are these people doing? They're all big and bulgy. Ooh. And then all of a sudden he's got movies and it's, you know, he was pumping iron and became more of a legitimate sport.
Juggling, now that gets a lot of flack.
Juggling is running while juggling at the same time.
I enter mile races where I'm the only guy juggling, competing against non-jogglers, as I like to call them. And sometimes I win.
Owen Morse has done 100 meters in 11.9 seconds. Juggling. Incredible.
I believe there's a priest that joggles while juggling bowling balls. Now that's okay. That seems fine, because, you know, juggling for the Lord is a whole different thing.
How is juggling like life?
People juggle their checkbooks, people juggle their lives, people juggle, you know, me being a woman, if I had 5 lovers, I'm juggling these men here.
I bring my life experience to my juggling, and juggling certainly influences the way I live.
I think you put all that garbage that happens and all that chaos that's in your life, and you put it into your objects, and for at least a half an hour every day, you can control it.
I just do it because I feel good after I'm done, you know?
I worked for Ringling Brothers for 2.5 years, and I was boss clown for a while, and I wasn't very old, and I had a bunch of clowns under my control, and I don't think I was quite ready for that kind of responsibility yet, and so I cracked, and I ran away from the circus. I'm probably the one that everyone else runs away to join, and one day I just woke up and I ran away.
Life is not a very happy experience. There is a lot of sadness, and those moments of sadness can make us very great people.
Well, as it teaches you how to learn so that I can approach anything I've never done before and learn how to do it.
Juggling's just like anything else in life. If you work at it, you'll do well. If you don't work at it, you won't.
I'm juggling my daughter, my marriage, my career, my family, my extended family, and it's just like 5 rings.
doesn't work, see?
When they did four clubs, the early guys...
Oh, yeah, they had to close the curtain.
There was no real way to stop. I mean, they closed the curtain on them. I mean, that was the end of their act, and then they dropped them.
They were so heavy, they couldn't catch them.
Now, and there's eight-year-old kids in there who know 20 ways to stop four clubs, so it's really hard for me to put myself back in that place, but, you know, it's written in the annals of history of juggling, so I'm guessing it was true.
Annals or annals? You said annals.
Annals. That was a joke.
We'll go down the annals. If there's an opening...
If there's an opening...
Hey, stop.
I do spend a lot of time juggling, and it doesn't earn me anything. But I do get a lot out of it, so I don't consider it an obsession. I consider it an investment.
There's a call to me that draws me out. I can't help it. I would be very incomplete without juggling.
So I would practice, you know, several times during the day. Then I had to go to school, and I had the balls in my bag, but I could put my hand in, and I could touch them, and be okay. I could make it to the next period.
I understood it. It was the only thing my whole life that I remember that I actually understood from seeing it. I broke my leg really bad, and I learned in bed in a hospital with some fruit that I had in a basket.
No practical application whatsoever. Pure abstraction, but not something, you know, where you're a talking head or you're a brain in a jar.
For me, it's as close as you can get to being magical and doing anything else.
When you're juggling, you're doing something that a lot of people can't do, and the better you get, the more individual you become, the more, you know, no one else can do this kind of feeling you get.
Yeah, it made me confident, and it made me work hard. It allowed me to be me.
And the confidence spreads to other aspects of life as well. I mean, all the other things you do, you say, well, you know, I could probably figure this out. I could probably break this down. I've done that before.
It captured a spirit inside of me that I think I can't believe I'm being emotional about this. You're gonna cut this out, right?
Right.
Okay.
An artist, for me, a musician that's an artist, is going to take the notes that we have. And they've been the same notes for hundreds of years, but there's been no limit to the amount of music that's been made with these notes.
I guess one theory of art is that there's got to be something to explore. You know, I mean, if it's already been done, it's just replicating. But when there's something to explore, something that hasn't been done before, then it can become artistic.
The greatest trick that I ever achieved with the Ice Capades when I was 19 years old was to juggle 9 rings, balance a mouse stick with a ball on top, spin 2 hoops on my right leg, and just move right down the center of the ice.
Albert Lucas does his act on ice, so if you miss, it's really bad because the thing will just go sliding across the ice and you're kind of screwed.
I can remember adults saying to me, "You're going on the Ed Sullivan Show." And I started thinking, wow, the Doors, that's right, the Doors were on Ed Sullivan. And then CCR was on Ed Sullivan. And all of a sudden, I remember that was the first time in my life where, wow, what if I did bad, you know? I realized what failure was.
Anthony Gatto is probably the greatest living juggler of our time.
the rate at which he learned, the ease at which he learned in comparison to other people, the level of difficulty.
Anthony got ahead, fantastic technique, Swiss gloves. This is alone, only alone in the world, and I don't know who is more in future.
He was basically bred to be an entertainer. He did the Ed Sullivan Show and the Carson Show.
You got your guys who come from a family, and since they're three or five or whatever, they're trained from that early age. By the time they're 9 or 10, they're phenomenal jugglers. But did they get into it because they love it or just because it's a family thing? Mm-hmm.
Here he was, the greatest juggler, renowned when you come to a convention.
Oh my
he
God.
Couldn't stand alone. People came around, gathered around him. But we'd go to Las Vegas, we'd be working there, and we'd be in some nice show opening for Tom Jones or whatever, making
Palace
great money. And we'd go downtown, he's at the
Nudes on Ice.
Nudes on Ice with Melinda or something.
Yeah, Melinda too.
You know, making $800,000 a week, and it was just...
Well, 800 a week. He wishes he's made 800,000 a week.
800 to 1,000.
Oh, to 1,000.
Yeah.
By the time he was 23, he was long past the best alive, maybe the best of all time. And then he quit at the prime. He quit not just performing, but apparently he quit juggling. He didn't touch juggling props anymore. That's all the jugglers talk about is why he quit and will he come back. And he's like Bobby Fischer, just kind of disappearing into the Soviet Union or something.
Someday I hope that he finds that passion and that he re-embraces it and comes back to it. But if he does it, some incredible things that young man did inspired many people.
And my prediction is there will be a comeback.
Oh my God.
When he finds his own, when he feels he has an identity again, I mean, it's impossible not to, and I think it'll be phenomenal.
Or if he goes, God, I got to make some money. Because, you know what I mean?
You have to teach kids how to juggle. You have to encourage them to do it. You have to encourage them to practice and to enjoy it for what it is. Because if you don't, then you're not going to have anybody else to keep juggling after you're gone.
If you have 100 great teachers, you'll have 1,000 great students.
I learned from a couple of elderly gentlemen who taught me. And one year I went to one of them and I was going to buy him a Christmas present to say thank you. And when he found out about it, he got wind of it before I bought him a present. He came up to me and said, you don't buy me a present. I said, why not? And he said, because you don't owe me anything. When I was your age, somebody taught me how to do this. He said, I can never repay him, so the way I'm repaying him is to teach you. So he said, when you want to repay me, you look for the next guy down the line.
How is the art or the idea going to spread? If you can't get it through your head, you have to teach other people.
The more interest there is in juggling, the more jobs there will be for jugglers.
And through juggling, everybody try open his soul, you understand, what he has inside.
Parents who thought their children were going to be in reform school were on stage juggling. So I think that serves a purpose, and I love to see that, and I want more children in the world. I think it's a really good thing, as Martha Stewart would say. It's a good thing.
The final trick, which coincidentally, I've saved for last.
All three using only the club.
And my other hand.
Look at that. Unbelievable.
Oh!
Once again, right before it hit.
Look, no one even cared. They didn't even applaud
this
or anything.
This is a bad pose. That's nice.
Hallelujah.
Where will juggling go? How good will it get?
It doesn't have a boundary. It'll find its own boundary.
The only limits that are placed on juggling are those placed by individual jugglers on themselves.
Juggling is in its infancy, and I really believe that. I believe the juggling explosion has not come yet, and it will come. It matters not the job you've got, as long as you do it well. Now, the things that are made by plans well laid, the test of time will tell. But you cannot count or know the amount or the value of a man by the show displayed or the beauty made by the touch of the juggler's hand.
I think I've sort of had my way with the world to the extent that I've taught a lot of people to juggle.
You're playing with toys and you're play acting and it's healthy and it's fun, and that's if you're gonna waste your time with anything, it might as well be a good time.
That's what I do for a living, if you wanna call it. If you call that living, I do.
It's really funny, I said, look where I'm at today, because I learned to juggle three balls. It's something really silly, and I learned to do it, and look how far it's got me. It's got me all around the world. It's got me a wife and a kid and a job in a big place, and I'm grateful for all that. I would never change it for anything in the world. Never, ever.
Enough talk. Just juggle.
Thank you.
Players' salaries and ticket prices have nothing to do with each other.
Here we go, make a jump from hand to hand. Jump! Oh!